There have been many enigmas in the history of paleontology. My earliest introduction to one was this book I borrowed every single week from the library, even before I could read. And inside was this. The massive size of these arms begged the question, who was the owner? How did it look like? I imagined the most terrible monsters, but it wasn't until 2014 that we knew. It looked like this. This is PNSO's Jacques the Deinocheirus, a giant ornithomimosaur in all his feathered glory. Estimated at 10 to 11 meters, or 33 to 36 feet, this model measures 30 centimeters, or 11.8 inches, which puts it right in the middle of that range for 1 to 35. Here's how it compares to a human. Now, the first thing we have to talk about is the color. Now, not since the Tsintaosaurus in Miragaya has a PNSO been so show-stoppingly beautifully painted. I'm sure you've all seen the release images by now. Not only does this stand up, it even outshines. I love balance of color and a cohesion in animal design with sensible highlights and accents. This Deinocheirus has it all. The accent of the teal, blue-green in the neck and head is balanced out by a hint of it in the tail blend here. The light patch of the hump, or the sail, is balanced in the feathers of the arm and the tail. PNSO still manages to sneak in some stripes, but incorporated so naturally, it neither irritates nor irks. The colors are really vivid. The overall effect is one of a strutting bird, looking about as it strides with dignity, be it among natural surrounds or its harem. Let's take a closer look. First, that beautifully rendered head. The color speaks for itself. I really love this blue-green and how it segues beautifully into the orange of the bill. And even the skin around the eyes is accented. Everything about it shouts showmanship. The anatomy is really good. The long, slender upper jaw and the more massive lower jaw, though I feel the lower could be a little deeper still. From here, you can see the spatulate beak and the dorsally directed external nares. And from the front, I've got a nice form of the beak. And also look at his baleful eyes. The jaw articulates and fits very tightly, so be careful here. And here's the inside detail. The pink paint is a little off in parts, but believe me, when you get this, you'll be so enraptured, you won't be looking this gift horse in the mouth. And down in the neck, you see the subtle but definite color variation. In his information video, Cao Chuang explains that he left the throat bare because it would have been an important area to lose heat from. And of course, we get to that masterfully sculpted wing. Look at the variety of color. The very, very faint mottling you can just make out. The light dry brushing here. Not to mention the form of the feathers themselves, as they transition from here down to the edge feathers, each with a definite vein, rachis, and barb structure. Cao Chuang notes that birds that fly have their most distal feathers the longest, creating a kind of triangular shape like this. While in flightless running birds, there are more rudimentary feathers that increase in length proximally, describing this kind of triangle instead. And that's what he modeled our Deinocheirus on, along with some looser feathers around the wrist, which would not interfere with using these claws. And here you can see them just peeking out. And even here, you don't get a one-color replication. Those famous arms are obscured laterally, but seen more easily on the medial side. And here, which would in most cases be obscured from view, you see more incredible detail in the feathers, the musculature of the arms, and even some subtle shading going on. You'll notice that the inner arm and an expanse of the chest and abdomen are also hairless. PNSO did leave some hair in to cushion the area while resting on the ground like an ostrich. The CE stamp is to the side, almost blending into the fur and thus minimizing
a visual and therefore a visceral betrayal.
This animal is meant to be viewed from all angles. And then that sail, tracking down from the top to the bottom, you can appreciate the detail as well as the color transitions. And where it meets bear skin, it lacks the kind of hair shirt abruptness I abhor in so many other figures. And down to the tail, just look at that pleasing pattern and that infusion of green. And because Deinocheirus had a pygo style, a feature also found in therizinosaurids and ovireptorosaurs, it's reasonable to assume a tail fan of pernicious feathers. PNSO based this one on Cordipteryx. And on the underside, no detail is spared. Now, even this little fade here. And even though feathers are the star, the naked skin is no less detailed, as we can see going up here. Now happily, the claws are broad and blunt, which is correct. And on the underside, a very nice spread of soft tissue. The idea is that this would help the animal distribute its weight more broadly as it waded in soft underwater substrate. Now while this stands quite stably now on this surface, sometimes it does tip over. It's quite hefty and you can expect warping over time, so you'll definitely need the stand. And here's a tip. You should never put this near the edge of a shelf, because a stand really helps only if the warping happens in this direction. If it tips in this direction, you're pretty much SOL. Even if it doesn't break, you'll damage this beautiful paint job. And finally, I'm delighted to say that this time, the accompanying poster is back to its usual standards, a painting and not just a photo of the toy. Now, just some interesting tidbits of Deinocheirus. In 1965, a huge pair of arms and some isolated bones were discovered, and for many years, this haunting image was all we knew of Deinocheirus, which means, aptly enough, horrible hand from the Greek deinos and hair. Now, this enigmatic fossil fueled much imagination about what the owner looked like. The celebrated John Ostrom and others did propose it might be an ornithomimosaur. In 2014, the discovery of two new and more complete specimens finally helped to fill in the rest of the picture. And today, we know it's not just in fact an ornithomimosaur, it's also the largest one, and the weirdest one as well. Now, this was a real surprise, because when I was a kid, ornithomimosaurs looked like these. And what we have here is, of course, something completely unexpected. And for a fuller history, check out the PBS Eons video I'll link to below. Now, based on these discoveries, when Li et al. Published their Deinocheirus paper, they proposed this revised cladogram. As you can see now, the most encompassing clade will be Ornithomimosauria, with Quebasaurus as the basalmost member. Then we have this split here, with the more primitive Deinocheiridae comprised of Deinocheirus, Garudimimus as a sister taxon, and Beishanlong. And then Ornithomimidae, which includes the Ornithomimosaurs we're more familiar with, such as Struthiomimus and Gallimimus. The skull is most unusual. It's similar to Ornithomimosaurs in length and narrowness, but the entorbital region is more elongate than in other Ornithomimosaurs. The premaxillae and the dentaries expand anterolaterally to form a spatulate beak. The outer diameter of the sclerotic ring is relatively small compared to the skull length, something that PNSO has tried to respect in their model. The high position of the eyes and the dorsally open external nares suggest that Deinocheirus may have spent considerable time partially submerged. The downturned jaws suggest low-level feeding. Now notice that the mandible is very deep, especially compared to the slender upper. And here, for example, is an ornithomimid jaw for comparison. This suggests a massive and powerful tongue, which could generate tremendous forces underwater for suction feeding. And of course, that duck bill, which suggests a similar diet to ducks and non-selective browsing as seen in some sauropods and hadrosaurs. Now, the jaws were edentulous, meaning toothless, and the chewing action was a simple vertical up-down mastication. To make up for this, more than 1,000 gastroliths were found in association with one of the specimens. Together, they suggest the chewing of soft vegetation or herbaceous water plants. The 10 cervical vertebrae become more trapezoidal posteriorly, creating an S-shaped curve that's stronger than in other ornithomimosaurs. Actual claw morphology has significance. Lautenschlager et al. In 2014 did an FEA on various pterosaur claws to study stress distribution in scratch digging, hooking and pulling, and piercing. The elongate claws in Notronychus, and more so in Therizinosaurus, experience high stress in scratch digging. However, Elcesaurus experiences low stress in all activity, with blunter, more compact claws similar to Deinocheirus. It's possible then that Deinocheirus used its claws for shoveling, clawing, and pulling up plants. And now the sail. Often, longer neural spines in dinosaur fossils get exaggerated in reconstructions. In the case of Deinocheirus, we can be fairly certain. The 12 dorsal vertebrae are all distinct, with the neural spines increasing progressively from the front to the back. The last neural spine was 8.5 times taller than the height of its centrum. Now, this is almost the highest ratio seen in Spinosaurus, so the peak is indeed quite high. Now, Li et al. Suggests that with a system of interspinous ligaments, they could have supported the abdomen from the hips and the hind limbs, similar to a cable-stayed bridge, which actually is one of my current interests. And by the way, I highly recommend Dr. Stephen Ressler's Understanding the World's Greatest Structures course. And of course, the sail may have been for display as well. Now, ribs attributed to Deinocheirus have been found with bite marks attributed to the contemporaneous Tarbosaurus, suggesting possible predation. The femur was longer than the tibia, which is opposite to that in fast-running animals, suggesting slow-moving. Now, massive feet with broad and blunt angles suggest something like a hoof, may have spread the weight and prevent sinking deep into soft, sandy, or underwater substrate. And finally, one Deinocheirus specimen was found with fish remains in its gastric contents. Now, whether they were deliberately omnivorous or very likely, the inevitable hoovering of fish as it suction-fed on underwater plants, it does show considerable time in the water. Now, taken together, the picture is one of a dinosaur that walks the soft embankments or shore and wades into pools and feeds and grazes on soft water plants like a hippo, but having to keep an eye out for Tarbosaurus. And this is certainly a far cry from the animal which Osmolska and Ronjevich in 1969 thought was a gigantic carnivore, concluding it used its four limbs, to put it poetically, for tearing dead or weakly agile prey asunder. Now, a word on feathers and fur. It seems to me that since All Yesterdays came out in 2012, it's been trendy to add fur, feathers and fluff to many a poor dinosaur, with pterosaurs and dinocheirids particularly hard hit. We do know of ornithomimosaurs with preserved feathers, but how much was covered? And what's the evidence for giving dinocheirus a full-body mammoth makeover like this? Once again, Dr. Mark Witton has an incredible post on the subject, so I don't see the need to do a detailed segment, and just link to the article below. But some of the points are, for heat conservation, large animals don't need to be hairy to tolerate cold temperatures, and those bigger than a ton can still be thermally neutral below 0 degrees Celsius. Mass homeothermy is effective. On the other hand, for losing heat, even naked, hairless animals have difficulty because their activity generates more heat than they can lose. Now, fur or feathers would just compound the problem. So for giant animals, we can reason they'd have even more problems, and fewer feathers may be more realistic. Or they could just spend all their time submerged to ameliorate the problem. Alright, some comparisons. Now first is the only other dinocheirus I have, the smaller Calectae. Then the GR Toys Pterosaurus. You can see how similarly bizarre they are in various respects. The Uteranus, the other large feathered dinosaur that PNSO has done, so you can compare the feathering detail. And finally, what about the animal that may well have predated on Deinocheirus, this beautiful PNSO Tubbysaurus, and nicely in the same scale bracket. So that's it. What a beautiful paint and sculpt, worthy of one of the coolest and most mysterious dinosaurs ever. The detail and the color, even in parts you wouldn't normally see, is really praiseworthy. It reminds me of what Bernard Hill said, that when he put on his King Theoden's armor, there was an engraved golden sun on the inside of the breastplate, which no one but he would ever see. And it just speaks of great professionalism and pride in PNSO. Deinocheirus is a very complete dinosaur, which started off mysteriously, and it took 50 years for that mystery to be solved. And while it's lost some sense of mystery, we would never say it was disappointing. And PNSO does it great honor in this rendition. I only hope we'll know one day what Spinosaurus really looked like, and before 50 years, because I don't think I'll be around then. So take care, my friends, and I'll see you soon with another video.